from the Department of Design at Edinburgh University, and my colleague here is Helene Turner from Tyneside Life. What I'd like to talk about with you is a project that one of our PhD students did as a case study recently discussed here.
I came to Tyneside Mind 2 years ago now as a fundraiser. My title is Business Development Manager, but I came ostensibly as a fundraiser and bid writer. And we were at the stage where Tyneside Mind had been a company limited by guarantee for just over a year when I arrived 2 years ago. And we were in a dilemma because our funding, our traditional funding sources were starting to dry up, and we thought if we want to expand and continue our services across Tyneside, then we're going to have to think of some sustainable way to get money in and different sources. And one of the things I was asked to do was to actually do a Reaching Communities bid via the lottery. And all my colleagues, it's not a very big unit, there are 30 of us, but I think there was only five or six of us who were full time. And my colleagues kept saying, can we have this, Helene? And will you write that, Helene? And we need so much money for this. Oh, and by the way, we need a new website as well. Will you do that for us? And I thought, you're really asking me the impossible. And then this alliance was forged between ourselves and Laura Warwick, who was a PhD student from Northumbria University. And she came in and we hosted her for 8 weeks, and she came and worked amongst us. We treated her like a member of our staff, and she asked all, as she would say, all daft questions. Why do you do this? What is it you do? What do service users think? What do you think? What would you like? So she's asking all these questions, and eventually we managed to design a project that I could then work up as a bid, and a successful bid at that.
So the key challenge here is what kind of health and wellbeing services could be offered in North Tyneside? So this was an area that hadn't been administered to by Tyneside Mining in the past. So this was a focus for Laura's attention in her study, but it actually became the opposite of the former, really. She was able to move out from that and address lots of issues around the way the organisation works. So in terms of the sort of actor profile, what Laura began to do was to look at how this new service could be developed. And she used a range of design for service or service design methods and tools in order to be able to do that. We have one or two other slides within this thesis template that we've used that we're not going to talk to in detail, but you can actually access because they're part of the bigger presentation if you want to look at those methods and tools. Laura's concern initially was how can methods and tools actually make an impact within a third sector organisation, VCS, rather than the kinds of organisations that have perhaps been used in typically and lots have written about them in the recent past. So product design and service systems within private sector companies and corporations, and some of the public service projects that have been carried out. So what we were addressing really was this big unknown about how some of these methods and tools would actually work within a small and community setting.
I think it's important as well to note that as we went through this process, we realised that there was a shift in culture, that what we'd had before, because we deal with largely with all colours, people who have mental health issues, whether that's anxiety, depression or whatever, they would come to us and they would find a safe space, but it sometimes became a bit of a tea club where they would come and they would feel safe and they would do what they wanted to do, but no progression was made. And the one thing that we found out from doing the work we did with Laura was that our project suddenly became very defined, and we had a beginning, a middle, and an end, and that made it extremely easy to sell to the funder.
So one of the friendly critic issues that Laura quickly picked up on was, why do you offer services which seem to be used again and again by some of your service users, your customers? Why don't they actually begin, have a purpose, and then finish? So, moving into the response, The service design approach led to a number of outcomes for the Tyneside Mind. A lot of these were based on a fundamental user-centered approach to the issues, and most of the work involved detailed conversations around the current practices of the organisation. And Laura's work, again, really required a lot of illustration and representation and diagramatic of the processes and the practices that were going on within the organisation. One of the things that she actually began to realise was that in order to really affect change, there was a fundamental relationship here with the kind of organisational culture, where the Tyneside Mind as an organisation and a set of staff actually receptive to the change culture that service design could bring.
I think the outcome of all this was, you know, after 8 weeks of glorious time, I didn't know to put the bid in. The bid was successful. We were rewarded with in excess of £427,000, which has since employed 4 additional staff. And the amount of work that they're getting through now, this is for a 3-year project. You know, we're moving now towards sustainability, and I honestly believe that would not have happened if Laura had been on board.
Thank you. There were a number of very distinct outcomes that came from the project, and the relationship with Tyneside Mind is now set to carry on. One of the things the university wants to do is to use its growing population of postgraduate taught students to be able to engage in future projects at a smaller scale. Working with that CBS organisation, it's actually created a lot of relationship with the